we'll talk about the test-driven development. We'll talk about lab test and no unit test. So we choose three different ways of test theories. Also, they are implemented in real commercial work, like gas, oil, and energy industry. And now my words, I go to the Bartek.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your kind introduction. Thank you all for coming here so early. I'll do my best to make it worth it. My name is Bartosz Papis. I'm from Transition Technologies. And together with my two colleagues, Konrad Grochowski and Kamil Subzda from Warsaw University of Technology and Wrocław University of Science and Technology, we have conducted an experiment to compare software development methods. The experiment was carried out in my company, the company I'm employed in, Transition Technologies. Transition Technologies mainly is focused on creating software for gas and energy markets. And one of their projects for one of their clients was used for this experiment, hence the second part of the title, on a commercial project for the industry. I will start with a bit philosophical introduction about change in general. Don't worry, I'll make it short. Then hopefully I will fluently focus on change in the context of software development, and that is writing computer programs. And I will briefly summarize methods, how we can deal with changes in software development. And because we have many methods, we usually want to compare them, which one is better and when. So I will briefly characterize what state of the art looks like in the field of comparing software development methods. I will show that this is an ongoing research topic. There are many, many publications. Yet, next, I will hopefully convince you that that there is still sense to make yet another experiment. And we feel that we found some valuable improvements in designing such experiments. After this, I will present some preliminary results of our experiment, and I will conclude with a summary. So, in 1924, one of Freudian psychologists, Otto Rank, has published a book, Das Trauma der Geburt, and he claims in this book that being born is the biggest trauma everyone experiences in their whole life. The reason for this is huge number of changes you undergo at single instant. So a newborn child needs to learn how to breathe, its senses start to work completely different, it needs to learn to feel temperature, it needs to learn to eat. And I don't know what about you, but recently, because I'm a father of half-year-old daughter, and hopefully she's somewhere here, or she will join us in a moment. So I learned that even children need to learn that they have hands. When they're born, they start seeing some random objects floating in front of them. These objects sometimes hit them in their face, and they don't know that these are their hands and they can control it. So huge, huge number of changes. And we are never able to sustain such huge number of changes in our life later. And this is very similar to programs, computer programs. When a software project is young, you can even rewrite it in one night or few nights. So it's easy to traumatize your code. And some people do it. But as the project matures, some invariants start to form, some core concepts, which as the time passes, are impossible to change. However, because as we know, requirements change, our clients change, we are forced to change our software. So how to deal with it? There are many ways. The simplest is to be strong. So you just bite the bullet and go on with your coding, implement the change, check everything, and ship it if it compiles. So has anyone ever shipped a change without testing manually? Yeah, some of us did. So sometimes there is no other possibility, but I hope we agree that if you have at least some decency, you at least test manually what you did. And this is the second method. You run the program, see if it works. But to make sure that you didn't break anything and that your code is still high quality, you can test automatically. And this is the main topic of this presentation. There are many ways of automatic testing. There are unit tests, integration tests, smoke tests, white box tests, user interface tests, many possibilities here. And I want to focus on unit testing. And in the context of unit testing, we have two possibilities: test last development and test driven development. And these are the two main methods we wanted to compare in our experiment. Which one is better and what are the differences? So test driven development was first described by Kent Beck in 2003. If you Google these words with this date, with this name, you will easily find his book. I didn't read it, but many people recommend it. So I think I can safely recommend it also. So working in test-driven development consists in going with three steps cycles. You start with a minimal failing test. Usually the test doesn't even compile because the thing the test wants to test doesn't even exist. Then you provide minimal implementation, just enough to make the test pass. And when everything works, you do some cleanup, some refactoring, applying solid rules, and then you go again. Minimal failing tests, minimal implementation. This is hard, as I hope you can imagine. Usually, you need to think in a very different way. You need to think, what test should I write to force myself to write what I want to write? You can't just go and implement something. You need to force yourself with a failing test. The things that are commonly said to be advantages of unit testing, of test-driven development, unit testing using TDD, are fewer bugs, better code structure, more confident developers, because it is said that test-driven development gives you good test coverage. So if everything is covered with a unit test, if you change something and break something, a test will fail. So it will tell you that you broke something. The code is more flexible. This is the direct implication of better code structure and always up-to-date documentation. Disadvantages are big entry costs. So as I explained earlier, it's very hard to work like this. It takes more time. And because of these two points, almost no one wants to work like this. On the other side, we have test-last development, which is more intuitive and classical approach. You start with an implementation, then you test it, then you refactor the code. The steps are said to be a bit larger because there is no official rule that says that the steps need to be minimal. However, as I hopefully will show during the presentation, if you're a good developer, you still want to do small steps here. But you are not obliged to. In test-driven development, you are forced to do small steps if you want to work according to the method. So advantages is definitely it's intuitive and fast, and it seems easy. Disadvantages are worse test coverage. Well, it is said to be in this way, and that's one of the things we wanted to measure in the experiment. And you may need to rework the code to make it testable. If you start with a test and then write the code for the test, then you are sure that the code is testable because you write it in the context of an existing test. If you start with an implementation, you may need to change it in order to make it testable. So that's also another huge advantage of test-driven development and disadvantages of test-last development. There is another method of programming, no unit tests. We call it ancient programming method. However, obviously, you can still use it for small, tiny programs. If your program has just three scenarios, it's easier to just run it and see if it works. However, you need to look out for the fact that programs suddenly get bigger and you wake up in the morning and you notice that you have 5,000 lines of code and no unit tests. And only yesterday they were so young. It's used also by people who think they never make mistakes. And sometimes you are forced to this situation because you have so-called legacy code, so very old code base with bad code structure, so not testable, and no unit tests. However, I will try to also address this issue at the end. So how to compare these methods? Most of the time people do it experimentally, and as you can see, there are many, many publications. This I've copied this table from this publication, and it's a systematic review from this year. So this is a live ongoing research topic, and even though there are so many works listed here, there are probably not all of them. Not all of them are covered by this table. However, we want to focus on industrial projects because they are something that reflects real life. Most of the time, academic experiments are focused on some toy examples, small programs, so they seem less meaningful than comparing on a real software. Another thing is that nowadays, a very popular model of employment in almost all IT companies is to hire students just after their studies. So we wanted to focus on writing industrial real software, but with students, so not very experienced programmers. And we have, up to now, we have found only one paper that deals with this. NI is non-informed, it's not a language, so we don't know what language the authors use. And this is the one thing we want to focus on. And some other things we want to propose as improvements to designing such experiments is the thing I mentioned, so real industrial project with students. The second thing, very important, all participants implement exactly the same requirements. So in many experiments, especially industrial experiments, people say that they have two projects in their company. One team goes with TDD, the other team goes with Tesla's development, and they say because these projects are very similar, the results are conclusive. So we think it's very important, and it's better for participants to implement exactly the same thing, because then you have alternate versions of history and you can make some sensible comparison. Of course, this is hard because not many companies are willing to pay many times for the same thing. The other part is separation from infrastructural concerns. I will explain this in more detail later. However, what I mean is that we didn't want to measure how well people are able to find documentation online or how well people are able to adjust to a third-party library. Unit tests help you write business code, business logic. And we wanted to separate these other issues and focus only on measuring how well people are able to write business logic with unit tests. The other idea is that every participant works with both methods. In other experiments, usually they have few developers working with TDD and few developers working with Tesla's development, and they continuously work with the same repository, fixing their own bugs. So this is too far from reality, in our opinion. So in our experiment, every week, people were switching repositories. So this is also the reason for this point, that developers were also forced to work with other people's code. And this is also very important because usually this is the reality. Another important idea is that at the end of the experiment, we have verified that people were really, if they were supposed to work with TDD, they were really working with TDD, and if they were supposed to use Tesla's development, they were using Tesla's development. So we asked participants to commit test code and implementation code separately. And thanks to this, we are able to automatically verify what was the order of modifications in the code base, whether the tests were first in test-driven development and then implementation, and the other way around for Tesla's development. The other thing was something that's technically called randomized block experiment. And not only our work, but most of other research is inspired by a field in science that has the most mature statistical experiments and methods for designing statistically reliable experiments. So has anyone have any idea what this field is? Yeah, very close. I mean medicine in general. So evidence-based medicine, that's the state of the art in medical experiments, has the most major statistical experiments, and psychology as well, and that's the common inspiration for such experiments. And they are not exactly as good as medical experiments. However, as I said, they are heavily inspired. And in our experiment, we divided participants into blocks to differentiate between advanced programmers and beginners. Also, we wanted to have large code base. This is common in industrial experiments. In academic experiments, usually the repositories have 2,000, 3,000 lines of code. So these are very small projects. I will explain this also in a more detail later. So some more details about the experiment. We had 19 students, and there are best out of 60 who enrolled for the experiment. This is a small number, but this is a necessity. We are unable to find more people that knew technology and could program well enough, in our opinion. So because we had 19 students, we prepared 19 Git repositories. And as I explained earlier, we divided them into three groups, intermediate and beginner. And corresponding repositories for intermediate were test-driven development repositories, 1, 2, 3, test-last development repositories, 1, 2, 3, and one repository when you don't have to use unit test at all. The beginner group with these repositories. And we also created a mixed group. We have randomly chosen some intermediate programmers, some beginner programmers, and created a separate group just to make sure at the end of the experiment that the separation to groups even made sense. So we compared how do intermediate people work with beginners. As I said before, We've incorporated a method switching cycle. So each week, every participant was working with a different method. For example, one participant could start with first repository for test-driven development, then they would switch to test-last development, and they could have a rest and work without unit test at all. The switch was always occurring during the weekend, so they would finish their work on Friday, then and after the weekend on Monday they would start with a different programming method. Before the experiment there was 2 weeks of training, so we wanted to make sure that all participants interpret the rules of the method exactly as we do and as I've presented at the beginning. So we present our definition of test-driven development, our definition of test-last development, and they were able to practice both methods 2 weeks before the experiment. There were 12 tasks to implement in 7 iterations. So roughly 2 tasks per week. And also they needed to fix bugs that were in the repository they were starting to work with. So the bugs were introduced by someone else, someone who worked before them. So that's the real life part of the experiment, one of real life parts. So some more attributes of the experiment. The groups were created basing on anonymous surveys. So 3 of us blindly reviewed all the solutions provided by the participants. We graded them, and according to our grades, they were divided into groups. The mixed group was created randomly, and repository allocation was also random. With some constraints. So, as I said, we didn't want anyone to work with test-driven development 2 weeks in a row. They had to switch. But otherwise, it was random. No personal information shared and limited access. So each participant during 1 week had access only to his their repository, and he didn't know what others are working on and what task they need to implement. No communication. This is only something we could ask participants to do. So we asked them not to discuss details of the experiment in the kitchen or outside of work. And uniform knowledge distribution. is what I mean by this is if someone asks us a question, for example, to clarify a task or some technical question about the language, we replied via email to all of them. So information was shared. Something more about the technical aspect of the experiment. So it was a data aggregation server for gas market. The main application of this software was to store signals in a database. A signal is a series of data in time. So we could have monthly signals, signals that have one value per year, weekly signals, minute signals, hour signals. That was mostly it. However, there were some additional features. I will present them later. The solution, which we have created before the experiment, just to make sure it's possible to implement this task, was 9,000 lines of code, more or less. And we have used .NET 4.5 with C# and Visual Studio 2015. We have used Hibernate as a relational mapper, Unity for dependency injection, WCF to use web services. So thanks to using web services, all implementations had the same interface and we could apply the same set of acceptance tests for each repository uniformly. And also we've used a library called Mapster to provide automatic conversion between data transfer objects from WCF to domain objects, which were used for implementing business logic. So the architecture of the solution was created according to a paradigm called domain-driven design. And basically it means layers, a data access layer. So we have a project that provides you easy access to a database. We have some database maintenance tool, which allows you to create database from scratch. We have a hosting component. It's an entry point for the application. This is the executable file, which sets up the database, sets up the web services, puts everything together using Bootstrapper, which configures dependency injection and makes sure everything works together. On the other side, we've provided an example client application. It was a simple console application that was able to connect to our server via web services. And participants were able always to verify manually how their solution works. So even if they had no unit tests, they could use the example client to call the functions of the server and just see what does it do. In the middle, we have the core part of the application, and this is the domain layer. So this is the part where all the business logic occurs. And endpoint layer, so web service interface, which only calls the domain layer. And what I meant by separation from infrastructural concerns is that all these projects were implemented and given to the participants, and they were allowed to modify only the domain layer and the way the domain layer is used by the endpoint layer. So they were obviously not allowed to modify the web service interface, but they were able to change the way it's called by the endpoint layer. This is the list of tasks participants needed to implement. I won't go into details, but basically, I hope you can see some obvious operations on signals. So you can add some data for a signal. Signals were organized in a folder-like structure, like in operating system. So you could create folders and add signals to them. So there was task for browsing for signals, reading signals by their path. There were also some more advanced features. For example, you could create a signal in a database, but there was no data. So what to do when client asks for data? So the easiest solution is to just reply with no data. However, you can also provide some interpolation. If you have two samples at some two ends in time, you can interpolate values in between. First order interpolation and so on. So the first important side conclusion from this experiment is the number of integration tests. You can see in the rightmost column, it's roughly 9,000. And when we finished our implementation of the solution, there were only a few hundred of these tests. Because when you write your own code, you know which parts are independent and you don't need to test for them separately. For example, the algorithm for interpolation is the same for monthly signals and yearly signals. You have two samples and you need to interpolate values in between. It doesn't matter whether they occur each second or each hour or each month. Unfortunately, after 2 weeks, we learned that the students were very creative in creating code that makes irrelevant concepts dependent on each other. So there were many bugs that first order interpolation was working for monthly signals but didn't work for hourly signals. So we had to multiply all of our integration tests to account for all possible combinations of input parameters. And this is what you get when you want to test unknown code. And if you want to save unit testing for later, even for your own code, because after a month you will forget what's inside, you will need to pay for this 10 times fold or something like this. As you can see, there were different types of features. There were very easy features, like deleting a signal. You need only three scenarios for that. If the signal doesn't exist, you throw an exception. If it exists, you verify that after it was deleted, it doesn't exist anymore. And you verify that if you delete a signal, its data also doesn't exist. And for example, first order interpolation is a very complicated feature, as it turns out, and it needed more than 1,000 integration tests. So the course of experiment was like this. Each week, a participant works with different programming method. And after each week on Saturday, we've run these integration tests, which were hidden from participants. And if any test would fail, we've created a bug report, a bug ticket in this repository with a code sample that participants could just copy and paste into the example client to see why it doesn't work. The code sample was loosely inspired by the code from integration tests, so they were still hidden. But we wanted to keep it as simple as possible, just to prove that the code is wrong. So something about the participants. There were 19 students, mostly in the computer science field. They were from different semesters. However, one common aspect was that none of them had any experience whatsoever as a professional programmer. And in the rightmost column, you can see our grades. It's an average grade from our assessments of the work. And we decided to divide them into intermediate or beginner programmers. So people who graded 4 or more were intermediate, and people with grade 3 or less were beginners. And as I said, after the experiment, we wanted to verify whether people really work with the software development method they were supposed to work with. So if they were in a test-driven development repository, we wanted to verify that they really did test-driven development. So at the end of experiment, we verified all commits from all repositories with such state machines. This is one example state machine for test-less development. So for example, in test-less development, if the project doesn't compile, this is a bad commit. You are never allowed to break compilation. This is different from test-driven development, where when you commit just the code for the test project, you can create a unit test that doesn't compile because it's a test for something that doesn't exist yet. So for test-driven development, these diagrams were different. However, they are so big that I didn't put them here. And so on. So in test-less development, you are not allowed to break any tests. This is, again, different from test-driven development when you can write a failing test and in the next commit you provide implementation that fixes the test. Of course, this is not the method you should use in normal work, but we asked participants to do that, so we were able to verify that they were really working with test-driven development or test-less development. So after classifying all commits from all repositories like that, we've calculated the ratio between good commits to the total number of good and bad commits. And in the rightmost column, you can see the conformity level of each participant. And we were happy to conclude that our groups we have chosen were made sense. So the intermediate group have all participants from the intermediate group, except one, had conformity ratio more than 50%. And in the beginners group, they all except one had less than 50%. And the difference was statistically significant. So the separation into two groups made sense. People were working very differently, depending on whether they are more proficient or less proficient. So now the results. The first thing we wanted to compare was the test coverage. As you can see, test-driven development in blue was consistently larger than test-less development in green, and the result was statistically significant. And these are the average results for all the groups and all repositories. If we check the results for the intermediate block, you can see that there is almost no difference. So this is second interesting conclusion from the experiment, that if you are a good programmer, you can match test coverage of test-driven development just by writing good unit tests, even though you're writing them after the implementation. The next result for the novice group is even more interesting. As you can see, the results are very different. And test-driven development gives you approximately, on average, 20% more test coverage than test-less development. So this is an interesting paradox, because test-driven development is viewed as something advanced, only for advanced programmers, and beginners don't even want to touch it. So this shows that if you are a beginner, then you really, the more unproficient you are, the more you should try test-driven development, because you have more to gain from it. Even though it's hard, even though it seems inefficient, if you try it, you have lot to gain. Also, you may notice that first two iterations were really bad. There is very big standard deviation. However, after that, it stabilizes. And also, for test-driven development, the results were statistically significant, that the standard deviation is also consistently smaller than for test-less development. So test-driven development not only gives you higher code coverage, test coverage, but also better stability. So it's the way people work when they are using test-driven development is less dependent on their individual characteristics. These are the results for the mixed group. And this is the last time I'm showing the mixed group, because the conclusion is that nothing interesting is going on here. The only thing that you can think it's interesting, or I'm thinking it's interesting, is that the division to groups made sense, because this looks just random. And when we look at the code in the repositories, usually it looked like that intermediate programmers were starting their work, they were fixing all bugs, cleaning up the code, writing good tests, just to everything this to be ruined in next week, when a beginner programmer introduced more bugs, broke the code, and wrote some bad unit tests. So thanks to dividing people into groups, we were able to compare test-driven development and test-less development in a more meaningful way. The other conclusion from test coverage results is to exclude first two iterations. Because of the very big variance, we decided to treat them as additional 2 weeks of training for the participants. Number of bugs. This time I'm also including results for the no unit test repositories in orange. No unit test repositories were something like control groups in medical experiments. In many other experiments, people don't do that, and it's hard to say whether the results are meaningful, because if your project is trivial and you can implement it without any mistakes without unit tests, then there is no point in comparing test-driven development and test-last development. So there were not many no unit test repositories, but we had some just to make sure that the tasks were hard enough for unit testing to make sense. And as you can see, most of the time, no unit test repositories had more bugs than other repositories. Otherwise, the results are not that meaningful as for test coverage. However, as similarly to test coverage, the results for test-driven development were more stable. So the statistical test for variance was significant, and test-driven development gives you better stability. For the intermediate block, you can see that there is almost no difference, and this is a direct implication from the test coverage results. And for the novice group, you can see that the results are very different. And this is also another conclusion that if you are a beginner, it's even more worth to try test-driven development. We also compared number of crashes. So for bugs, it was an implication of misunderstanding or not clear enough definition of tasks. And I hope it's obvious that even if you interpret the task differently, you shouldn't ever make the server crash. So we measured the number of crashes separately, and the results are very similar to bugs. So usually when you're writing without unit tests, you had more crashes, and results for test-driven development were usually consistently smaller than test-last development. However, this result is not statistically significant. For the intermediate block, as with bugs, there is not very big difference. This is also a direct implication from test coverage. So these people were able to write unit tests after the fact, but these tests were still good. As opposed to novice developers who had a lot to gain from test-driven development. So some problems we are aware with this experiment. Test-driven development was something new to almost all participants. So this is a very common effect that if you have something new, then you're more eager to try it out. So probably people were working differently with test-driven development than with test-last development in terms of their attitude. Context switching, so the fact that people over the weekend had to change between test-driven development to test-last development and back again. So even though this was our aware choice, it may have caused some confusion. The Hawthorne effect is something commonly quoted in research when the research deals with people. And this effect causes people to behave differently if they know they are being observed. We were talking before the experiment that maybe we should keep it as a secret so people wouldn't know that this is an experiment. However, we concluded that there would be possibility that they accidentally learn, for example, in the kitchen or outside the work, that they were writing the same thing. And they would get suspicious, start asking questions, and it would do more harm than good. So we decided to be just open about it and tell them that, listen, this is an experiment, please don't talk about it. However, they knew they are being observed. So this also may have some effect on the results. Small sample size, small number of iterations, and small number of people statistically speaking. However, this is a necessity because more people and more time means more money. Also, students usually have time only during vacation to work full time. So this is something that is hard to improve. Dependent samples. This is something I hope we will be able to fix when we'll process the results further. However, we have used t-tests, also called student tests, which assumes that the samples are independent of each other. And in test coverage, it's obvious that test coverage from iteration two, from second iteration, depends on test coverage from the first iteration. So formally, you're not allowed to use t-test for this. However, possibly we could calculate the difference and increase or decrease, and then we could use the t-test. And too much variables. So obviously, we wanted to account for that. So we divided students into groups, so they would be less divergent. However, the tasks were very different. As you saw in the task summary, there were some tasks which needed only 3 tests to verify them, and some of them needed 1,000 tests. So this was a high variability. Also, the students were from 3 different cities, from different universities. So probably they were taught programming very differently. But this is something you always have to deal with. And usually you do it with a big sample size to average everything out. And this is hard. This is hard when you want to have real projects and you want to hire people to work on this project. Because you need to pay them. So a summary. Test-driven development improves code coverage, and this result is statistically significant and is also conformant with most of other works and other publications in this kind of research. And also the second point is something that contradicts the other research, so it's the more it's interesting, and is that more proficient programmers can write unit tests as good as with test-driven development when they're using Tesla's development. So what really matters is to have good unit tests. And what are good unit tests? If you're interested, I recommend a great book by Roy Osheroff, The Art of Unit Testing. It's the one with a samurai on its cover. And even though the book is a bit dated, the author explains in a very good way that bad tests can do more harm than good, and good unit tests can improve your code quality very significantly. And this leads me to the third point, that unit testing improves code quality. The results were statistically insignificant for all the groups. However, if you remember, for the novice group, the results were significant. The side conclusion, when I presented the task summary, is that unit testing of unknown code is hard. So if you leave unit testing for later, you will pay for this, because you will be testing unknown code. You don't know what's inside. So to be sure, you need to account for all possible combinations of input parameters. And this makes the number of unit tests or integration tests explode. More strict rules of test-driven development give better stability. And I hope if you think about it, it makes sense, because in test-driven development, if you want to work according to the method, you are forced to do as small steps as possible. So this forces you to think more about the task, because you need to create more fine-grained subtasks. So you find more corner cases, you ask more questions about the task, and you have better code coverage, because each piece of implementation is a result of a failing test. In Tesla's development, if you don't care about it, you can just write the whole code at once and then try to unit test for all the possibilities. And obviously you can miss something, especially if the code is big. One of the most important conclusions is that test-driven development is more beneficial to beginners. So even though this seems not to make sense, the results show that if you are forced to work with test-driven development, as in this experiment, or perhaps if you are eager enough, and I hope you will, if you don't know test-driven development, you will give it a try, then you have much, much to gain. And the other side conclusion, the experiment turned out to be a very good recruitment method. So we've recruited people that had conformity ratio more than 60%. Because we know that these people, when they are given instructions, strict instructions, they are able to follow them. Even if they don't knew test-driven development, they were working hard to work according to the method. So these are good employees. Okay, so if I was mumbling too much, if my English is not very good, or if I was just boring, then now I will present the final slide. So if I were to choose the one thing I would like people to remember from this talk, if I was incomprehensible before, write unit tests. And write good unit tests, and give test-driven development a try. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much. Now we know that we should write unit tests, yes? But sorry, Bartek, I just want to add something about your sentence. For example, me, with my example, I strongly believe I never do mistake. I just choose a little bit longer way, you know? So thank you a lot. We are open discussion. We have some time. The first question, who is?
So I wonder about the part that the test subjects had to conform with your requirements of TDD and TLD. How do you think that impacted the results? Perhaps maybe leaving those bad comments would be more realistic because people in real situations make mistakes.
Yes, that's a very good remark. Perhaps we should have measure how we work with test-driven development ourselves, because probably you're right that it's impossible to have 100% conformity. However, I think it's important to see, well, obviously some people had 70% and some people had 30%. So there is a difference in conformance to the methodic, and these people were to do the same tasks. So it was possible to have at least 70%. So somehow if someone works erratically and doesn't try to think too hard about how he should work, then the results are biased and meaningless.
Okay, thank you.
I've got a question about the intermediate group, which had the same results, whatever the method, right? Is it possible that because they had to switch every week between the method, that they developed some kind of intuition how to write the production code that's testable so that the coverage converged for both methods?
Yes, a very interesting remark. I didn't thought about it, but it makes sense that probably if they were working with test-driven development long enough, then even when they switched to test-less development, they were thinking about the test. But I think this is a good thing. If you give test-driven development a try, and you then conclude that it's too hard and it takes too much time, so if it makes you write better unit tests with test-less development, then even the better. But yeah, that was probably one of the reasons.
That's where I think also. But on the graph, there was a gap at the beginning on the 2 weeks.
Yes.
It converged. And then you said you just ignored the first two iterations.
Yeah, it was mainly because the big standard deviation. So the results were at least completely random.
Okay. How would you explain the peak in the number of bugs on last iteration?
All the peaks in the results were probably an implication of the hardness of the tasks. So I'll try to go back. So as you can see, the tasks are very, very different in terms of complexity. So the peak in the middle were the interpolation tasks, and the peak in the last iteration was the get course data. The get course data was that you were able to read data for a signal that, for example, you have weekly data, but you want to read it as per month. So you need to automatically calculate averages in a Windows and return the result to the client. So it was one of the hardest tasks, as well as interpolations. So That's what I referred to when I said when I was talking about too much variability. So the tasks were very, very different, and the shape of the graphs was probably a direct implication of hardness of the task for each iteration.
Because if I remember correctly, the beginners didn't have this peak, and the division between beginners and intermediate. Yeah, for novice block, it seems similar for iteration. And for intermediate, it peaks. So that's
yes, interesting. You're right. It peaks, but not it's not as big difference as in intermediate group. Interesting remark. We'll definitely look into that. So okay, I'm sorry, I cannot explain it right now, but yes, it seems interesting.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you a lot, Bartosz.
Thank you very much.
A lot.